Hello everybody, good morning. Wow, this is like a big wall of people. You know, it's like better than the wall of confusion we are trying to overcome actually, right? So I've looked at the program, it's going to be really, really interesting. I saw topics are related to continuous delivery, serverless CI/CD pipeline, automating the data center, Kubernetes, Docker, experiences, implementing secure DevOps. So it's going to be really, really interesting 2 days. But first you'll have to do 45 minutes with me while I'll provide you a practical path for becoming a high performance organization, actually to implement all these types of things. Because in the end, that's what we're doing this for, right? I mean, it is about reducing the cycle time in your organization, allowing your organization to deliver products faster to the customer. But before I go there, of course, we had this amazing introduction video of myself. A small bit about me. I'm 20 years in the IT industry now. Up until 2004, I started to, I worked with Java development, namely. Then I moved more towards architecture. As of 2011, I started to focus on continuous delivery related topics. So I started to automate the continuous delivery pipeline, deployment automation, test automation, build automation. And as of 2012-13, I started to focus on DevOps-related topics. So I also started to focus on automating the data center itself and advise organizations what they need to do, also from a cultural perspective, a process perspective, and an organizational perspective. I'm technical at heart, so whenever I get a chance, I like to keep my fingers on the buttons, and the latest things I'm playing around with, of course, is Docker and Kubernetes and the Google Cloud Engine and that kind of stuff. And I hope everything that I'm talking to you about today comes from all the projects I've done from a developer, architect, but also as a consultant and the trainings I've provided, the trainings I've written on this topic, and I hope you find it useful. But enough about me. This is a DevOps conference, right? So when I was looking on the internet about definitions, what is DevOps? You see many definitions out there. And most of them are overlapping, some fall short, some are a bit over the top. But I ran up against this guy. Does anybody know who this is? Yeah, I hear you. I'll tell you the answer. It's Donovan Brown. He's the principal DevOps manager for Microsoft's Cloud Developer Advocacy Group. And he's also part of the League of Extraordinary Cloud Developer Advocates. So it's a terrible name, I know. And they find it themselves the same thing because it all started out as a joke, but actually it became quite big. And what these guys do is they advocate DevOps everywhere where possible. You can really see it, right? He's really living it. He's feeling it. And his definition I find really interesting because DevOps is the union of people. So the way that we work, the way that how we work alongside one another, the processes, so short and lean processes, and of course the tools that we like to use, automation tools, automating every single step out there, to enable continuous delivery, so achieve cycle time reduction for delivering your product to your end user, of value, so not just technical components, but really end user value to our end users. So even the customer is mentioned in this definition, and I like that very much. So basically he's saying it's not just about automation tooling, because of course DevOps is a very hot topic at the moment because it hurts the most, because it's really complex to get this into an organization. You see many products out there, and they're pushing like you've got the HashiCorp products for managing your credentials vault, of course, Kubernetes, XL release, XL deployment automation, the console for scheduling your Docker containers, all stuff that I really like and enjoy playing around with, of course, and that makes my heart tick, actually. But if we want to really become a high-performance organization, we need to strike a balance between other topics as well. And basically, we need a right mix of a high-performance culture, an organization which facilitates speed of delivery, an architecture which facilitates speed of delivery. We would like to go to processes that are as lean as possible and fast as possible and flexible as possible. We would like to automate every single manual step out there. And of course, we would like to go and we would like to measure in which direction we're going, so know what we are doing. Because how fast we can go is actually just as fast as the weakest link or the kink in the cable. Yeah? Because what use does it make if we say we're going to automate the deployment, so we're really fast in deployments, while the rest of the organization is working alongside waterfall processes, for instance. What sense does it make if we say we're going to change the architecture, but at the same time, we're not allowed to change the organization that produced it in the first place? Or, well, we change the culture, so we're going to change the way we work, but we're not allowed to measure, or we cannot measure, whether we're going into the right direction. Doesn't make sense, right? We will not be able to really speed up. So we need a right mix of any of these topics. Now, why is it actually that we're doing all this? And for that, I take you to this diagram. And this diagram depicts the average lifespan of a Standard & Poor's 500 company. And as you can see, the lifespan went the last 80 years went down from 67 years all the way down to 15 years. And there's even studies suggesting that within the next 15 years, the average lifespan will even decrease further to about 5 to 7 years. Now, having said that, one can imagine or think about, okay, what is now the company's strategy to survive if this is a given, right? Will they try and prolong their current product, the lifespan of the current product? Or will they look into new inventions and give life to new products? Now, the answer, of course, is that these organizations need to become innovative and think out new products. But many problems many companies have an issue with this, of course, because they are trapped in what is called the Horizon One dilemma. And I will go to that in a few seconds. But basically, it comes down to that you have organizations that already have products which are really successful in the market. And these companies find it difficult to penetrate new markets. And instead, what they do is they spend their innovation budget on expanding the product that they already have, basically improving it. It's not really innovation. They improve it by adding new features, more features, features that people do not even use. And by that, they make their product more upmarket. And at the same time, they create a gap for the small disruptive companies with their small and lean and cheap minimal viable products to enter the market. So they dig their own hole, actually. And of course, a textbook example of this is Kodak. In 1975, Steven Sesson was sitting in his lab and he invented the digital camera. The thing weighed about 3.6 kilograms and stored all of his photographic material on a tape. Very interesting invention. But there was one problem. Kodak was earning its money off making of development of films. 80% of the profits came from that area. So this was a disruptive technology, actually. And the company was 165,000 employees worldwide, made about 2.5 billion revenue year over year, and had $80 stock share, $80 a share. So it was really a healthy company. But management decided to park this invention, because they did not really see a market, and the market was too small to basically add up to their ambitious growth ambitions. So they started to park the invention, and that's a very dangerous strategy, because it's a wait-and-see strategy, right? And in Japan, meanwhile, they did not have this issue. They did not have this product which was disruptive. So they started to invent the digital camera, of course, and within the next 15 years, they put it on mass market, and that was about the same time that Kodak went completely down the drain. So, okay, I was talking about the Horizon 1, 2, 3. Yeah? So if you want to have an invention, so as an organization, you need to look into innovation, come up with new products in order to survive. And typically, if you want to go to innovate, you go for three horizons. In Horizon 3, which is far, far away, you basically try out as many business hypotheses as possible. So you try to get as many numbers of validated business ideas. So if one wants to have one good idea, one must have many ideas. So you try them out over there as cheaply as possible. You take out this one good idea, you move it over to Horizon 2. This is about growth. So you start to expand on it. You make it scalable. You make it big. You make it robust. You start to market. You start to spend money in it, get market share. And once you're over there, once that's done, you move the product over to Horizon 1. And this is where you start to operate as cheaply as possible. So you maximize profit over there. And actually, Kodak was stuck in this Horizon 1, right? They had this product only focusing on this, totally disregarding that the world moved on and that new inventions were around the corner. So what I'm trying to say with all this is that it's no longer about the product. I put a tulip here. I'm from Amsterdam or the Netherlands, so I put a tulip. So it's no longer just about the product. A company is about the garden of products. Yeah? So a company should be able to build new products, let products die off, and give life to new products instead of holding on to just this one product. And this is where DevOps comes into play. To be responsive to continuous change, we need a garden to facilitate speed of delivery. And that's what we are doing, right? We want our company to be flexible, speedy enough, and to basically be innovative in this market and to survive in this hard market. So, having said that, what do we need to achieve? We need to tackle a couple of things. We need to have a high performance culture. We want to move towards an organization which facilitates speed. Basically, we want this organization to be as autonomous as possible. You would like to have an architecture which facilitates speed, so move away from the big monolithic architecture and basically split it up. You would like to move towards processes which are lean and as short as possible and as less processes as possible. You would like to automate every single manual step that you can. And we would like to apply measurements to see whether we're going into the right direction. Now, in the next couple of slides, I will go to each and every one of them. And after that, I'll provide you a path on how you can implement this in your own organization. First thing is culture. Now, culture is a hard topic to put to change in your organization. You cannot oppose it from top down, right? If I want to have a campfire culture, for instance, I can tell people, you should go sit on the beach on a piece of wood and have a campfire culture there, but it will not be a culture because people will just say what I was saying, but you want culture to grow from within. So typically what I need to do if I want to have a campfire culture is to put pieces of wood on the beach, to put a guitar there, to put some drinks there, maybe a bag of marshmallows, a few sticks. And when many people pass by, a couple of them will sit on the wood. Some will put marshmallows on a stick. Maybe somebody else will play the guitar. Somebody else will pour the drinks. And when many people start to apply certain practices, you will give rise to a culture. So if I want to change the culture in a certain direction, I have to get the context right so that people will start doing the things that we want. So if I want to have a culture of quality first, I must make sure that test tooling is readily available whenever I need it. And I need to make sure that I automate every manual step out there, because that will basically get better for your quality of your software, because the most errors are made by doing manual labor. If I want to get towards a culture of continuous improvement, I must make sure that I'm able to measure how my organization is doing, how my software delivery pipeline is doing, how my products actually are doing. I need to have monitoring in place so I'm allowed to steer. If I want to have a culture of taking responsibility, I must ask people not to perform specific tasks, but I must ask them what objective I would like to achieve and allow this user to get his own ideas about how to achieve this objective. And typically, you want to put them in product teams instead of the siloed organizations as we know them today. If you would like to have a culture of trust, you must have transparency. We would like to have management walking around on the work floor. We would like to celebrate successes just as much as we would like to celebrate failures. And we want to learn. We need to have openness there. And finally, if we want to have a culture, for instance, of experimentation or risk-taking, then we must make sure that with a press of a button, we have our sandbox environments available and we can try out our experiments. Because if I have an idea, an hypothesis, and I have to wait for 2 months for my system to be there, yeah, the whole idea is gone, of course, so I will not innovate. So that was culture. If we want to change the organization, you typically would like to move away from the siloed project-based organization and move more towards a product-based organization, which means you put a group of people around a product, make them responsible for this product. And this team is end-to-end responsible. So from concept to grave, it builds the product, it maintains the product, it operates the product, and lets the product die out. It is typically value-driven, so you provide an objective for the team, and the team should not deliver a piece of technology, but a real product that can be used by an end user. And the team itself is cross-functional in nature, so we really start to appeal towards the T-shaped profiles of peoples in there. So instead of only doing your specialism, you typically like to ask people, okay, what else would you like to do? And how can you contribute to delivering this product to the market? Now, of course, you have this end-user product, but this end-user product makes use of other products in the organization. And typically, these are software-run products, like platform products, infrastructure as a service, a container system as a service, or cloud as a service. But they also make use of software delivery products like your IDE or your software delivery pipelines or test automation tooling, deployment automation tooling. And this team makes use of business value optimization products. Basically, these are the products that you use for monitoring whether you're going into the right direction, what the conversion rate of your product is, and so on. Now, these products need to be maintained as well. So you put product teams around that as well. And now you start to create a network-based organization. So you have these teams, and you can build other end-user products. And these teams are end-to-end responsible for creating one or more products. And basically, I put the tulips in here. You have every product team creating a product, or maybe you have two product teams working together on one product, one to delivering a functional slice. And same goes for the internal teams. They also create and use and apply products that can be used internally. Now, also, we want to have an architecture which is driving team autonomy. I can go into microservices and stuff like that, but the talk is too short for that. We can talk about it later. But the main thing to deal with is Conway's Law. And Conway's Law says that any piece of software that we create is a direct reflection of the organization that produced it. So if we have a complex organization, we're bound to create complex architectures. So if you ever get the chance or the idea that you need to simplify architecture in a complex organization, do not do it. First, make sure that you're also allowed to change the organization that produced it. So you would like to have this organization create this architecture. You will have your end user applications over here. You have your infrastructure based applications over there. And you would like to connect. You have API driven, self-service, automated fulfillment of the products. So whenever I need a piece of software or a software delivery pipeline, I press a button. If I need an IDE, I press a button. If I want to have a piece of infrastructure readily available and I can use it, I just press a button. I don't need to call anybody anymore. It should be really completely self-service and API driven. And at the same time, these applications, of course, can need to talk to one another. That can be done through optimized integrations. And typically, these would be what they call dump pipes and smart endpoints. So you would like to get rid of the pieces of technology in between. Also, we'd like to have processes which support speed of delivery. Now, often in your organization, you're probably doing this part, right? You have a backlog refinement and some sprint planning, at least if you're doing Agile and Scrum. You have a sprint planning and you have your implement over there. But it's just as important to do it on this side as well. So you would like to have an intake initiative, marketplace evaluation and portfolio planning before you put stuff on the backlog. So first of all, it's about doing the right things. And then we start to do the things right. And you would like to have a feedback loop from right to left. And you would like the business as closely put to your end user products team as possible to make this loop as short as possible. We would like to automate every single step, of course. So that would mean if you have an end user product team, if a developer enters the system, presses a button, gets immediate access to the IDE that is required, to the virtual machines that he needs on the system, to the continuous delivery pipelines which are needed to deliver software, and basically all the ports open to the system so they can start, program, or create or build on the product as fast as possible. And at the same time, this process needs to be completely automated as well, right? If we check first in version control, we check code in, we push to master, immediately a build runs, static code analysis happens, unit tests, component tests, system tests, functional tests, deploy to the target systems, get feedback on your monitor, back on your screen outside, which is out in the open. And we want, of course, to have, automated infrastructure. So which means by press of a button, I either have infrastructure as a service, a PaaS platform as a service, a container platform as a service, as long as it is completely automated and it basically fulfills your needs. And finally, we want to have everything measured for effectiveness. So on the left-hand side, we want to use employee satisfaction and DevOps maturity levels to see where we're at from a cultural perspective. In the middle, you want to look at speed and quality. How fast do I deploy? How often do I deploy? How often does my deployment fail? And what's my mean time to recover? So how fast am I able to recover? And on the right side, you start to measure the actual value and the customer satisfaction for your product. And this feedback left goes to continuously improve your own process, and on the right, it is used for determining strategic direction. Now, this was a lot to take in, I can imagine, but these are the ends in mind, right? This is what we're aiming for. And now we need to get there. That's not easy, of course. So I typically do this often in organizations, so I created a path for it. First of all, let me tell you how you should not do this. You should not treat this as a big change program. So don't throw in a bag of money and say, okay, we're going to do this because we will change, and then we go back to business as usual. And probably all money will be spent on tooling and technology only, and we totally forget to change our organization, our culture, and our processes. At the same time, you do not want to transform in isolation. What you see happen so often is that the IT run operation, the operations department has money, wants to innovate, start working for 8-9 months on a new monitoring system, new Kubernetes system, and it's now finally it's out there, and then IT delivery needs to use it, and they're like, well, we cannot use this. We don't want to be like this. This is not secure. I don't know. You know, it doesn't work. Locally, you met your objectives. We have a new platform, but nobody's really, really using. The same goes for IT delivery, of course. They say, well, let's implement new processes, or let's change our architecture, or go to microservices. So we're going to spend all money on it. And then finally come to IT operations, and they say, like, well, we cannot run this, and we only deliver once every 2 months. So then you match your local objective, but still do not have end-to-end value. Same goes for the business. We are going to have a new scope. We're going to have a new culture, different way of collaborating with IT delivery, but still it's local. What we would like to do is to go from top to down. We have one KPI, and that's speed of delivery and quality of delivery. And business IT delivery and IT run needs to work together in a simultaneous fashion. And that's what the plan promotes. So starting point is to put out really, really ambitious KPIs. I don't know if you've heard about the State of DevOps report, probably pretty famous now out there. Yeah, about the last 7 years, I believe they surveyed about 55,000 professionals worldwide, from CIOs to test engineers, development engineers, operations engineers, database engineers, whatsoever. And they came to a conclusion that there's a big change, a difference between high performers and low performers. I won't go into the actual numbers, but basically they say that the de facto standard for a high performer is that, if my clicker works, is that that we typically deploy on demand. If we have an idea, we can bring it to production within less than an hour. We can fix it within less than an hour, and only about 0 to 15% of the deployments that we do really fails. And what I'm saying here is set out ambitious KPIs, because as if your organization is working at this level at the moment, and you'll ask the organization, okay, we're going to use this level, we're going for this level, what will happen is we only improve on what we were doing in the first place. Yeah, we're going to do things better than we did them last year. But if you're on this level, and I will ask you, you need to go to that level, you get a lot of discussion. You really need to change the way that you're working. Well, we cannot do that fast. We don't have automation, or I'm working on a project, the processes are rigid. And those talks you want to have, because we want to change, we don't want to improve. Implementing DevOps in your organization is a cultural, process-wise, organizational change. So what's the target? So you have, on the business side, now I'm going into the plan. So you have the business and the product teams working together. You got two product teams over here. They're end-to-end responsible for an end-user product. And you have three product teams over here. The software run products, software delivery products, and the software monitoring products. These are the five teams that you're going to work with. And you call these blueprint teams because you're going to do it right as of day one. And over here, you will have, you will have team run, team delivery, and team monitoring. They are responsible for run, delivery, and monitoring products. And these teams are end-to-end responsible. They are cross-functional in nature, the people there, not just technical specialists, but really people that want to broaden their perspectives and work with other technologies as well. They operate value-driven, so you don't tell them what to do, but you tell them what you would like to achieve. So it's really mission command. They strive for complete autonomy, so they always automate their interfaces and everything out there. They focus on automation wherever possible, so they don't keep on doing things manually. They really automate straight away, and they continuously improve their processes, both as their products. So not only is product phase, also the processes. Okay, how would you go through this path? Over here you see the current situation, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, these are the phases. And typically you will have a preparation phase and you'll have a couple of teams over here. So you start out, of course, with the preparation phase. I will tell you in a bit what is happening there. At the same time, you work with the two blueprint teams over there, and you work with team run, team delivery, and team monitoring over there. And the key here is synchronicity, synchronicity in work. So we are going to apply certain objectives to these teams, and they need to work together in order, before they are even allowed to pass number two over here. Yeah? So these are acceptance criteria that need to be fulfilled. We need to have achieved our mission. And what we're doing now is functionally slicing our transition in small. So instead of doing team run, delivering one platform, team monitoring another platform without even talking to the blueprint teams, they're working together and functionally slicing the delivery, because that's when they start to add value. And when we met our acceptance criteria, you move over to the next phase. Yeah? So, okay, how do we do this? Typically, you want to decide where the information is. So as opposed to that somebody else is saying, we're going to do this, and you have to do that, and you have to do that, you apply missions to the teams, because the teams know best, the people in the teams know best what it is, what needs to be done in order to meet these objectives. So really apply this principle, decide where the information is. So that's by the teams. So typical objectives in the preparation phase, for instance, this is still the IT lead team thinking up the program, is like safeguard funding. Of course, we need money for this, right? Get commitment from all the blueprint teams and the operations teams involved, so that they have the people available and that they really want to make an effort and to make this work. Establish boundaries for the teams. So make sure that the teams know which products they will have in their portfolio and where the architectural boundaries are. And set up communications. Very important. Make sure you have a central site out there where people can read where it is, where you're going, where you're at this very moment. Set up Q&A sessions within the organization so you can explain what it is, what you're doing, and where you're at, and so on and so on. This is really, really important, because otherwise you get a lot of questions. Now, typical objectives for Blueprint Team 1 and 2 is, for instance, establish a flow of requirements with your business and build this product and let this product run on this run, deliver, and monitoring team's product. Now, maybe you give them a maximum of 4 objectives, not more than that. These are 2 of them. And the objectives for team run are establish a flow with the blueprint teams and build your first version of your infrastructure as a service component. And make sure that the blueprint teams are running on your product, are utilizing your product. The same goes for continuous delivery. Set up a requirements flow from the blueprint teams, build your first continuous delivery pipeline as a service by a press of a button, and make sure the blueprint teams are utilizing this first version. And the same goes for team monitoring, of course. Productize monitoring as a service, get the flow going, and achieve this objective. I see over here, I forgot to tell about this track over here. This track is for the teams that are not yet part of the transition, that you typically would like them to prepare their current application stack to eventually become part of this track. Now, talking about pulling the pain forward. These are nettles, we call them brandnetels in Nederland, in Netherlands, so they itch. This is a very difficult thing to do, because what you will see now is that people will have, they think they cannot do this, or they have conflicting interests. What you will even see is that these blueprint teams say, well, the business does not align, which I find strange, of course, because I thought we were always aligned with the business. So what you will see happening here are all the problems that you have been working around with in your organization over the last couple of years. Within an organization, you were probably used to working around the problems that we already have. And now all of a sudden, all of the root causes of the problems will become available. We need to work together. I don't know who my business representative is. This person doesn't know how to automate. How does this work? So we need to tackle these things. So we are really, really learning here. So luckily we do it in small now, with 5 teams. We're not transforming the whole organization. And that's what this is all about. We learn here. Now, these teams need to achieve a certain objective. So these teams are also allowed to decide which profiles are part of the teams. And the same goes for the other teams. So typically, a Blueprint team might have a Node.js developer, a Java developer, some ESB developers in there, a Scrum Master, which is the rotating role. Same goes for Team Run. So they might be more focused on using Ansible for provisioning their systems. They're using a Linux environment, so they need Linux knowledge. They need Kubernetes knowledge in there and a test engineer. And the same goes for the team delivery. So they need Ansible, but they also need to do something on build automation. So they also want to have Jenkins knowledge in there and Kubernetes knowledge. And for team monitoring, might even be more focused on the Elk stack, Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana, or AppDynamics. So you need this knowledge over there. But you can see this is a really easy way for these teams to tell, okay, I need these profiles, this is what I'm going to do to achieve this objective, and they need to set up this flow of requirements so we can work towards the end goal. Now, in the process, each of these product teams, of course, needs you want to have certain dynamics. And I don't know, has anybody of you heard of this DASA, DevOps Agile Skills Association? I see one finger up, okay. Now, DASA too. DASA is a DevOps Agile Skills Association. It's an open members-driven group which really moves out there and is all focused on basically certification and training around DevOps. So they promote that and they create a curriculum and they create material around it on what is needed for an organization to implement DevOps-related principles. And basically, I say there are six principles, and we want to apply those to the teams. And first of all, it's customer-centric action. So we would like the people in our teams, and also the team itself, to think, okay, how will the customer use this product? So it's not just about delivering a technical component, but really listen to the customer, measure whether it's used, and when it's not used, also draw your own conclusion like, okay, this is not a good idea. Let's remove this piece of functionality. Because I don't know if you know it, but 65 to 70% of the functions that we develop as a developer is seldom or rarely ever used. Can you imagine how much waste that is in the process? So we really want to have customer-centric action. We would like to create with the end in mind, because create with the end in mind is very important. I believe it's from the 7 habits of highly effective people. If we create with the end in mind, two things will happen. One is we will know in which direction we need to go. And two is that every single step that we take to achieving this objective will be aligned with this objective. So it's very, very powerful for this team to understand which direction we're going. DASA principle 3 is about end-to-end responsibility. So from concept to grave. And like Werner Vogel says, you build it, you run it. There will be no handovers of products from one team to the other. You build this product, you take ownership of this product, and you operate this product. It's very important, because otherwise you get development teams moving software over to operations department and say, bye, and go do something else. That's what you don't want. You want to have high quality software, so you're responsible for what you create. DASA principle 4 is about continuous improvement of continuous functional autonomous teams. So these teams are autonomously as possible. Typically, you would like to have T-shaped profiles in there. Because I know how to program, but I can do other things as well, very well as well. But somebody needs to appeal to it, need to ask me like, hey, do you want to organize something? Well, maybe I'm really good at organizing things. So I do that as well. So you typically want to appeal to people's secondary and tertiary skills. DASA principle 5 is about continuous improvement, of course. And within the current organization, many organizations see that improvement is only focusing on the product itself. But you also would like to look after the garden, you know? We would like to look after the processes and the way that we achieve our products as well, because it is about garden, it's not only about the product. And DASA principle 6 is about automating every single step that you can. So whenever we see a manual activity, we automate it. And sometimes we think we're there, but very often when I go into development teams and they develop software, I'm asking, okay, how do you put it live? Then still there are some manual steps and somebody has to pull a lever and chasing and blow a whistle or whatever, and then the software is going live. We want to have it completely automated. Now, okay, that's a lot to take in. what do I particularly like about this approach? And we're using this at our customers. So first of all, the approach immediately takes out everything from many angles. So it makes your culture, it really focuses on culture, on leaning your processes, on optimizing your architecture, your automation, everything with it. So you will get immediate value. You immediately see whether you're going into the right direction. It is also low risk by starting small. So instead of transforming the whole organization, you just start out with 5 teams. If you note that you are not successful with these 5 teams, you'll be happy that you did not do it for the complete organization. So if we're not capable of doing this for 5 teams, then just stop this transition. We're doing something wrong. So we're not spending money on everything else. Just see whether we can do this with 5 teams. It delivers value straight away. So it is immediately from end to end, business, IT delivery, and IT ops will move faster for the teams that are part of this transition. It also, you also take responsibility as of day one, which is very important in a DevOps-like environment, right? That you really provide a mission and that the teams can decide for themselves what it is, what they need to do to achieve this mission. So you immediately do this as of day one, which is a very important aspect. The synchronicity that is required in this step, Blueprint 1 and 2, working with team run monitoring and continuous delivery, really asks for collaboration, so really pulls the people together because they need to have the same functional objective, which is very powerful. Functional cohesion is stronger than logical cohesion, which you see in different silos. If we have the same end goal, we probably work better together than we are like based on specialisms. And it's small enough to be treated as an innovation. As we start out with 5 teams, you typically can pay this out of your Horizon 3 money, right? So Horizon 3 is about innovation. We're now innovating the way that we work, innovating the organization itself. You can pay it out of that fund and say, okay, we're going to try this because we think this is going to be a success. Now, of course, there are things that I like, but there are also pitfalls. So there's a lot to absorb for one team. You will notice that working with one team, you're going to explain this, then in the beginning, probably the team might get lost. So you need to deal with that. You need to explain over and over again. You need to write things down, provide the presentation, maybe send out certain books describing this topic to the team so they start to understand what it is what we like to achieve. Second is there's uncertainty for the teams which are not part of the first batch. So teams that are left out of the transformation, for instance, technical component teams, might wonder like, okay, but what's going to happen to my team? Because we're talking about end-to-end products. So you need to talk to these people. You need to include them and communicate with them what it is what you're doing and what might indeed be the end result. Because probably you might want to get rid of some component teams. Initial teams might grow large because your start architecture might entail many technologies. Probably you want to have all these technological aspects within one team, and you will see that you have large teams. So then immediately you know you need to start working on team shaping, the profiles, and people working together and sharing knowledge and learning other stuff. Another pitfall is that the teams that are part of this transformation, the first 5 teams, is that they probably will slow down their regular product. So this is an investment from their side as well. So product development will slow down, but we learn things in other ways. We learn different processes, different culture, different organization, maybe change architecture. Also, a certain level of seniority is required. You can typically tackle that by in every of the team to put really key engineers there that understand what I have just explained to you, like the DASA principles and so on. So they can take care within the teams itself to spread this knowledge and immediately basically change the way that we work if this is needed. And again, collaboration as of day one is also a big pitfall, because people might not be used to really collaborate in a different manner than we're used to. So with this, I conclude my presentation. So I'm right on time. I had to speed up. I heard it in the beginning, so I was like, so now I'm too early almost. But I want to leave you with this final thought. Yeah? DevOps is about establishing a garden for your organization, a garden in which your organization can become innovative and basically push products to the market at high pace and at a flexible speed. This is what it's all about. Yeah? So, and this is not only technology driven. Of course, I like to do that. I like to play around. It is for a large part technology driven. I find it amazing actually that as IT people, we created products which are completely technology driven, but we forgot about to automate our own processes. But anyway, it is technology driven, but it's also about people, attitude, the way that we organize, the processes that we use to get our job done. And finally, so it's not about the product, it is about the garden, it's about the many products. And we need to treat this garden as a first class citizen, our context as well. This was my presentation. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, Michael.